अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन, आई एम शेफार ज़ारा। आई होप यू ऑल आर फाइन। टुडे आवर टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज़ रेगुलेशन ऑफ प्रोटीन फंक्शन। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट आवर टॉपिक। वन ऑफ द क्रिटिकल फंक्शन ऑफ द प्रोटीन इज़ इट एक्टिविटी एस एंजाइम। यू आर वेल फेमिलियर विद इट एंड दीज एंजाइम्स दे आर बेसिकली नीडेड टू कैटलाइज ऑलमोस्ट ऑल बायोलॉजिकल रिएक्शंस। So we can say that the regulation of enzyme activity, it plays a key role in governing the cell behavior. So how these enzyme regulation of enzyme activity is being carried out, or you can say is being achieved. This regulation is being achieved through at two levels. The first is at the level of gene expression, and at this level the amount of an enzyme, or you can say the protein, a cell synthesizes, it is being determined. At another level, and that level is obtained by the regulation of protein function, not only the amount that is produced by the cell but also the activities of the constituents of proteins is also determined. So this is how the regulation of enzyme activity is being achieved. Now we will discuss three general mechanisms by which activities of cellular proteins are being controlled, and the first is regulation by small molecules. So most of the enzymes, they are controlled by changes in their conformation, and as a result of these changes in their conformation, their catalytic activity is also being changed. And in many cases, such conformational changes, they result from the binding of small molecules. These small molecules can either be amino acids or nucleotides, and what these small molecules do is that they regulate the enzyme activity. So this type of regulation, it is commonly responsible for controlling the metabolic pathways by feedback inhibition. So what is this feedback inhibition? Feedback inhibition is actually a type of allosteric regulation in which the product of the metabolic pathway, it inhibits the activity of an enzyme that is involved in its synthesis. So what is this allosteric regulation? This allosteric regulation is basically the regulation of enzyme by small molecules. These enzymes bind to the site distinct from the active site, and as a result what they do is that they changes the conformation and the catalytic activity of the enzyme, as we have discussed before. So now let's see the example. For example, you can take the example of the end products of many biosynthetic pathways. So let's say that we take the example of amino acid biosynthetic pathway. So what happens is that the end products, they inhibit the enzymes that catalyze the first step in their synthesis in this amino acid biosynthetic pathway, and as a result what they ensure is that they ensure an adequate supply of the product on one hand, while on the other hand they prevent the synthesis of excessive amount. So this is how the small molecules they regulate. So here is the diagrammatic representation of the feedback inhibition, and the end product of the biochemical pathway, it basically acts as an allosteric inhibitor and of the enzyme that catalyzes the first step in its synthesis. And I have told you that what is the allosteric inhibition. So the feedback inhibition is actually an example of allosteric regulation, and in this allosteric regulation what happens is that a regulatory molecule, it binds to the site of an enzyme that is distinct from the catalytic site. Here allo means other and steric means site, so the name signifies that what will happen in this regulation. So the binding of such a regulatory molecule, what it do is that it alters the conformation of the protein, and as a result it changes the shape of the catalytic site and affecting its catalytic activity as well, because the shape will be changed, so the catalytic activity will ultimately will be changed. One of the best studied allosteric enzyme example is aspartate transcarbamylase. And what this enzyme do is that it catalyzes the first step in the synthesis of pyridamine nucleotides, and it is regulated by the feedback inhibition by cytidine triphosphate, CTP. Here you can see the structure of cytidine triphosphate, CTP. So what is the structure of the aspartate transcarbamylase? Aspartate transcarbamylase, it consists of 12 distinct polypeptide chains. along with the 6 catalytic subunits and 6 regulatory subunits. And what happens is that the binding of CTP to the regulatory subunit of this aspartate transcarbamylase, it induces a major rearrangement of the subunit positions, and as a result what it does is that it inhibits the enzymatic activity. We will see in the diagram how it happens. So here in the diagram you can see that before the CTP it attaches, the enzyme is active, and later on what happens is that when the CTP it binds, so what it do is that to the regulatory subunits, what it do is that it changes the conformation, and as a result it inhibits the, it makes the enzyme inactive, and inhibiting is enzymatic activity. So this is how it happens. Many transcription factors, they are also regulated by the binding of small molecules, and the example of is that the binding of lactose or a metabolite to the E. coli lac repressor. What it do is that it induces a conformational change, and this conformational change, it prevents the repressor from binding the DNA. In eukaryotic cells, steroid hormones, their function is also similarly controlled the gene expression by binding to the transcriptional regulatory proteins. Regulation of translation factors such as EFTU by the GTP binding, it is also another common mechanism by which the activity of intracellular proteins are being controlled. So what is this EFTU? EFTU is basically a prokaryotic elongation factor, and that is responsible for catalyzing the binding of an amino acyl transfer RNA to the ribosome. In this case, what happens is that the GTP bound form of the protein, it is active conformation, while the GDB bond form is an active one, and many cellular proteins are similarly regulated by GTP or GDB binding. We will discuss them later on. So as I have said before, that other cellular proteins, they are also regulated by GTP or GDP binding. So one of the example of such protein is the RAS oncogene protein, and this RAS oncogene protein is basically, this RAS is a family of related protein which is expressed in all animal cells, lineages and organs. So we'll discuss that how GTP or GDB binding affects it. So this RAS oncogene protein, it is being intensively studied because of its role in the control of cell proliferation and in human cancers. And X-ray crystallography analysis of these proteins, they have shown the important conformational differences between the inactive GDB bound and the active GTP bound forms. So you have to keep this in mind that the GTP bound form is the active one, whereas GDB bound form is the inactive one. So this slight difference in protein conformation, it determines whether the RAS, that is in the active GTP bound form, it can interact with this target molecule or not. And by what happened by this interaction is basically that it signals the cell to divide. So the importance of this, such a slight difference in protein conformation, it can be illustrated by the fact that the mutation in RAS gene, for example, if mutation takes place in RAS gene, it contributes to the development of about 15% of human cancers. So the 15% of human cancer is the result of this mutation in the RAS gene. So this mutation, what they do is that they alter the structure of the RAS protein so that they are locked in the active GTP bound conformation, and they continually signal the cell division. And you know that cancer is basically the unrestrained growth of the cell. So what they do is that these mutations, they continually signal the cell division, and as a result kya hoga ke the driving, as a result they will result in the uncontrolled growth of the cancer cells. So this was the abnormal RAS gene, whereas the normal RAS protein, it will alternate between the GTP and GDB bound conformations in such a way that they are active only following stimulation by the hormones and growth factors. And that normally these hormones and growth factors, basically they normally control cell proliferation in multicellular organisms. So this is how the mutation and how the GTP and GDP bound forms, they play an important role. So your next mechanism is protein phosphorylation, And the examples that we have discussed in previously, they were basically the examples of non-covalent association of proteins with small molecule inhibitors or activators. Because in them, no covalent bonds were formed. So the binding of these regulatory molecules to the protein, it is readily reversible. That allows the cell to respond rapidly to the environmental changes. On the other hand, the activity of many proteins, it is also regulated by covalent modification. And one such example is the regulation of one such type of regulation, you can say example regulation, is the activation of some enzymes by proteolytic cleavage of inactive precursors. So what is proteolytic cleavage, or you can say the proteolysis? Proteolysis is the breakdown of proteins into smaller polypeptides or amino acids. So what happens is that as a result of this proteolytic cleavage is that this proteolysis, first remember this, that the digestive enzyme and the proteins that are involved in blood clotting, they are regulated by this mechanism. So the proteolysis is the irreversible mechanism, and it provides a means of controlling enzyme activation rather than just turning on and off the proteins in response to the changes in the environment. In contrast to the proteolysis, phosphorylation, on the other hand, is reversible within the cell, and it functions as the allostatic regulation, which we have discussed before. And what it does is that it reversibly activates or inhibits the wide variety of cellular proteins in response to the environmental signals. So protein phosphorylation is catalyzed by the protein kinases. And most of which transferred the phosphate groups from ATP to the hydroxyl group of the side chains of serine, threonine and the tyrosine residues. Most protein kinases, they phosphorylate either serine or threonine or tyrosine residues. And these enzymes which perform such action are called as protein serine threonine kinases or protein tyrosine kinases. The names are written in the slide, you can see that respectively. And protein phosphorylation is reversed by the protein phosphatases. And what these protein phosphatases do is that they catalyze the protein, they catalyze the hydrolysis, you can say the hydrolysis of the phosphorylated amino acid residues. Like protein kinases, most protein phosphatases are also specific either for serine and threonine or for tyrosine or for just tyrosine residues. Although there are some protein phosphatases, they recognize all the three phosphoamino acids. So this is how the protein regulation is being carried out by through phosphorylation. So here in the diagram, you can see the protein kinases and phosphatases. So the protein kinases, they basically catalyze the transfer of phosphate group from the ATP to the side chains of serine and threonine, as we have discussed before, that is your protein serine threonine kinases or tyrosine residues. Okay, so you can see here in the diagram. So what this protein phosphatases do is that the protein phosphatases, they catalyze the removal of phosphate groups from the same amino acid by hydrolysis. So here you can see the structure of serine, tyrosine, and the protein tyrosine kinase. So what happened when the protein kinases and protein phosphatases, they act together? So the combined action of the protein kinases and the protein phosphatases, they basically mediate the reversible phosphorylation of many cellular proteins. And these protein kinases, they function as components of signal transduction pathways. And in these signal transduction pathways, what happens is that one kinase, it activates a second kinase, which may act on yet another kinase, means it will activate another kinase. And this sequential action of the series of protein kinase, they can transmit a signal that is received at the cell surface to the target proteins within the cell. And as a result, what happens is that changes in the cell behavior takes place in response to the environmental stimuli. So the prototype of the action of protein kinase that we have discussed above, it came from the studies of glycogen metabolism that were conducted by Ed Fisher and Ed Krebs in 1955. In muscle cells, the hormone is present that is known as epinephrine or adrenaline. It signals the breakdown of glycogen to glucose 1-phosphate. And as a result, what you do is that it provides an available source of energy for increased muscular activity. So this is the function of the epinephrine. So now we will see that how the glycogen breakdown takes place and glucose production takes place. So what happens is that the glycogen breakdown, it is catalyzed by the enzyme glycogen phosphorylase, and this reaction is regulated by protein kinase. Epinephrine, which I have told you that it is present in the muscle cells and hormone as a hormone. So kya hota hai ki epinephrine, it binds to the cell surface receptor that triggers the conversion of ATP to the cyclic AMP, which then binds to and activates the protein kinase. Ye bind ho jayega protein kinase ke sath aur se activate kar dega, and this protein kinase is known as CAMP, dependent protein kinase. You can see it is written here, cyclic AMP protein kinase. Here this AMP is basically the abbreviation of adenosine monophosphate. So what this kinase do is that this kinase phosphorylates and activates a second protein kinase that is called as phosphorylase kinase, and the phosphorylase kinase in turn, it phosphorylates and activates glycogen phosphorylase, and as a result it leads to the production of glucose. This activation of activating phosphorylation of both the phosphorylase kinase and the glycogen phosphorylase that we have studied, they can be reversed by the specific phosphatases. So the removal of the initial stimulus, that was epinephrine, it inhibits the further glycogen breakdown. So now let's understand through the help of diagram that how the regulation of glycogen breakdown by protein phosphorylation takes place. So what happened in the process, once again we will repeat, is that the binding of the epinephrine to the cell surface receptors, the receptors that are present on the cell surface, it triggers the production of cyclic AMP, that was your adenosine monophosphate, and as a result what happened is that it activates the CAMP, cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. This cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase, it phosphorylates and then it activates the phosphorylase kinase, and which in turn phosphorylates and activates glycogen phosphorylase, and this glycogen phosphorylase then catalyzes the breakdown of glycogen to glucose 1-phosphate. So you can see that how epinephrine, it attaches to the cell surface at the receptor site, then the cyclic AMP, what it does is that it triggers the production of the cyclic AMP, and the activation of cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase takes place, and later on the activation of phosphoryl kinase, and lastly you can see the end product is your glycogen, it is being converted into the glucose 1-phosphate. So this is how the regulation of glycogen breakdown by protein phosphorylation takes place. So the signaling pathway that leads to the activation of glycogen phosphorylase is initiated by the binding of small molecules at the cell surface. Means the epinephrine, it binds to its receptor, and the cyclic AMP binding to the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. The signal is then transmitted to its intracellular target by the sequential action of the protein kinase, and the similar signaling pathways in which protein kinases and phosphatases play central roles, these pathways are also involved in regulating almost all aspects of the behavior of the eukaryotic cell. And for supposed aberration in these pathways takes place that involve the abnormalities of protein kinases, they are also responsible for many diseases. Just like we have discussed the mutation in the oncogene, so they also, aberration in these pathways, they also cause many diseases that are associated with improper regulation of cell growth and differentiation, and particularly they will also result in the development of the cancer. So the last is protein-protein interaction. Many proteins, they consist of multiple subunits, each of which is an independent polypeptide chain. In some proteins, the subunits are identical, whereas in other proteins, they are composed of two or more distinct polypeptides. But in either case, interaction between the polypeptide chain, they are important in regulation of protein activity. द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ दिस इंटरेक्शन इट इज़ बेसिकली इट इज़ एविडेंट इन मैनी एलोस्टेटिक एंजाइम्स सच एज एस्पार्टेट ट्रांस कार्बामाइलेज दैट वी हैव डिस्कस बिफोर एंड इन विच द बाइंडिंग ऑफ रेगुलेटरी मॉलिक्यूल इट ऑल्टर्स द प्रोटीन कन्फर्मेशन बाई चेंजिंग द इंटरेक्शन बिटवीन द सब यूनिट्स. Many other enzymes, they are also similarly regulated by the protein-protein interaction. And an example of such an interaction is cyclic adenosine monophosphate-dependent protein kinase that we have discussed. And it is composed of two regulatory and two catalytic subunits. And in this state, the enzyme is inactive. The regulatory subunits, they inhibit the enzymatic activity of the catalytic subunits. So the enzyme, it has been activated by the cyclic AMP, and the cyclic AMP, it binds to the regulatory subunits and it induces a conformational change that leads to dissociation of the complex. The free catalytic subunits, they are then enzymatically active proteins, kinases. Cyclic AMP, it acts as an allosteric regulator that we have discussed before, and by altering the protein-protein interaction. Here in the diagram, you can see the regulation of cyclic AMP-dependent protein kinase. And in the inactive state, is the first one, it is being marked. In the inactive state, the enzyme consists of two regulatory and two catalytic subunits. You can see that. Regulatory is denoted by R and the catalytic in the purple is denoted by C. And the cyclic AMP, it binds to the regulatory subunit. And it induces a conformational change. You can see the change in the shape of the enzyme, and as a result of this conformational change, it leads to the dissociation from the catalytic subunit. Conformational change will take place and this regulatory subunit will dissociate from the catalytic subunit, and the free catalytic subunit, they are now enzymatically active. So this is how the regulation of cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase takes place. So this was all about the protein regulation and regulation of protein function, and I hope you have understand up till now what we have discussed. And if you want to study further, you can visit these both sites which I have mentioned in the slide, and thank you for watching.